out to me, and one of the things I thought would be interesting to learn more about is a little bit about your background, that you were born in Hawaii, for instance.
Yeah, born and raised in Hawaii, that's correct.
Yeah, and I think you're third generation?
That's right. My great-grandfather traveled to Hawaii from Okinawa, I believe in 1904.
Wow.
And then after 2 years or so, he called his two sons, my grandfather and his younger brother. So my family have been in America for over 100 years.
Wow, wow. And as I recall, your great-grandfather did an extremely courageous thing, the way he came, the way he left Okinawa and went to Hawaii, right?
Well, you know, in those days when they left the homeland, they never expected to go back. And I think that in itself is takes quite a bit of guts, if you ask me.
I would think so.
And I remember traveling back to Okinawa with my mother when I was eight or nine. And from Honolulu to Yokohama, it took 10 days.
Oh my God.
You know, steamship.
Yeah.
And then we had to, we took a plane from Yokohama to Naha. DC-3. And on the way back, we took a ship, but that took 3 days. So it's quite a trek.
Yeah, yeah. Well, in any case, I was struck by another thing I read, and that is that your father had been farming in Hawaii.
That's correct.
But you guys lived close to Pearl Harbor.
That's correct. It's called Iroquois Point. And it's it's just next to the channel that goes into Pearl Harbor.
So the farm was destroyed when the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor.
On December the 7th, the farm was strafed.
Yeah,
strafed. And my aunt was out in a water tower waving to the Japanese pilot.
Oh my God.
They could see the faces, they was that close.
Oh my God.
But the farm was relatively intact, but the next day they were ordered to leave.
I see.
The order to leave because we learned later on that it was apparently had already been planned because all the Japanese farmers were kicked out.
You were left. You had to leave because you were Japanese.
Well, we learned later on when we were applying for redress and all of those documents came out.
So you were interned, your family?
Yes,
was interned.
They were interned, yes. They were allowed to go back during the day because they had livestock and things of that nature. But eventually they did lose their farm.
Wow.
My father did lose his farm and he never really financially recovered from that.
Gosh. He took up carpentry, I think?
He farmed a little bit here and there, but eventually he became a carpenter. Apparently, I had not known that, but after high school, maybe during high school, he had learned some carpentry, so he had a skill, but he was also went to school to become a welder. Mm. But because he was Japanese, he was unable to get a job to go to Pearl Harbor and other military bases where they needed welders. And so he had to work for industry. Mm. And so anyway, that's pretty much the story. I'm not too clear about his early experiences, but that was a very, it was very, it must have been very painful for him and the family, yes.
It's a great trauma.
Yes.
Of all the trauma that was taking place.
Sure.
That was part of it. And am I right in thinking that your father had a kind of feeling for craft, a certain ideal maybe, or for something well made, or?
Yeah, you know, I guess it's hard to know because we lived on a farm and we had to do everything by ourselves. So I picked up a lot of skills from him, carpentry, plumbing.
Yeah,
I don't like to do those things, but you know, so I can do little things, but I'm not afraid to venture into these things if I need to for myself.
I think I read that a temple carpenter, a certain particular temple carpenter, had been kind of an ideal for your father.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. He would mention this Hidari Jinguru. He's a very famous carpenter in Japanese woodworking lore. And he was so good, he wanted to prove his worth, so he cut off his right hand, according to legend, and still he was able. And one of the skills in a Japanese carpentry is to be able to plane a piece of wood without, you know, this, like a strip of paper for the whole length.
Wow.
And he was able to do it with his left hand.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So that's the story.
Would you say something about your Okinawan heritage? Because I learned that there's some differences, significant differences, in terms of the culture of Okinawa and the culture of mainland Japan.
Yes, quite a bit. Okinawa was an independent nation until 1879. In 1879, the Japanese came with their army, kidnapped the king, annexed Okinawa and made it into a prefecture. They took the king and his entourage to Tokyo as kind of a hostage. And so that was the end of an era. There was an end of an era for us. And the while Japanese and Okinawan, Ryukyu, the old name for Okinawa, Ryukyu, are similar. You know, the language is similar. But it deviated about 1,500 years ago. So, but in the Okinawan language, there are many very ancient Japanese words that are not used today because it's kind of a backwater, and we kept the old languages. And culturally, of course, we're quite different. We're quite different. The Okinawans were great traders. They went to China, Japan, Korea, Southeast Asia, to Thailand, Indonesia, to Malacca, to trade.
Okay.
And they were in a good place because in the past, sailing ships could not go a long distance before they had to get water and fruits or whatever. So Okinawa was just ideally located in.
I see.
On this outside.
So
outskirts.
People would stop in Okinawa,
yeah,
from other cultures.
And so they made a lot of money.
Yeah. Well, I understand from something that I read that you wrote that because of the history of Okinawa and being at times sort of taken over by other powers, that they had learned to adjust, and they had to adjust over and over. And
yes,
one of the results is that there came to be a kind of openness to new ideas, new cultures, new conditions, out of necessity maybe, but then it became ingrained, a kind of...
Yes.
Openness to the new.
That's
true. Is that fair?
I would think that's fair. That's a fair assessment. And a minority people, I guess the word is peripheral peoples, wherever they may be, that's a phenomenon. We have to be able to negotiate two different cultures, yeah, our own and the host country, as it were.
You know, it's interesting. I can't help but wondering if there's a kind of a comparison with Jewish, you know, the Jewish and the Okinawans. I've never thought of that.
That could be. I'm not sure, but I'm sure the Jewish people have the same experiences, getting kicked around.
Well, that's what I mean. The Jewish people were, Israel, I guess, was taken over. I don't know much about the history, but the history seems
sure
to be an adaptation
right,
to all kinds of cultures, learning how to function
right
under different laws, different customs, different powers. And one thing that one gains from that potentially is there's a lot that one gains in terms of a kind of alertness and openness and
resilience.
Resilience.
Because we've had to maintain our own identity. And the Okinawans do it through song and dance. They love to sing, they love to dance, they love to drink.
Yeah.
And so you know, there's a certain kind of camaraderie that we kind of know each other by our names.
Yeah.
So there's certain surnames that are Okinawan and not in a Japanese, so we can identify people.
Has the Okinawan have the Okinawans been successful in holding on to a culture, do you think?
That's a hard question. You know, the further we get away from the homeland, as it were, it gets harder and harder.
Given the advent of all the technical changes going on, and here you are living in the West and in the Bay Area, what is the effect on traditional cultures and in Asia in particular, the spread of Western technology, Western values, and in a way the erosion of traditional value, traditional cultures? What are your feelings and what do you see in terms of this kind of world change as in a way history disappears?
Sure.
and things become media rich and
right. All
that that's happening today and this minute, this second.
Yeah, it's very painful in many ways because we know, at least I see, that the erosion between the respect for the ancestors, and it's really a different worldview. The Okinawans and most traditional societies that believe in or emphasize ancestral veneration. That's really the crux of it. But they believed, for example, fundamentally, that's kind of a shamanic tradition, that we share this world with innumerable disembodied spirits, including our ancestors. And it's very difficult for people to accept something like that now because they assigned it to superstition.
Exactly.
It's sad, but the only way that we can really counter that is to make sure our children respect us. I mean, you know, so try to cultivate that I'm not sure if it's a belief in spiritual, but at least a respect. Acknowledgement that they did not come here by themselves, but they have this long lineage in which they can be very proud of.
How could you talk about a respect for your ancestors being quite the opposite of a superstitious view, but in fact a view grounded in some really thoughtful principles that I think we could easily respect if we only understood what the ground of these views.
From all my studies and my own experience is that ancestral veneration is really based on the virtue of gratitude. That's all it is. And this is a virtue that is not very much appreciated or taught in the West. But gratitude for all living things. And so shamanism has that. That's why they can name, they say there's a spirit that exists in the rock or the tree or the ocean or the pure water. And we should be thankful for that. Yeah. and for your parents, your grandparents. So we need to teach our children, people around us, that this is indeed a worthy virtue to cultivate.
Wouldn't you also say that we need to understand something more about our interconnectedness and our interdependence?
Oh, yes. Well, you know, that's a prime Buddhist ideological construct. And Buddhism believes that all beings, all things, all time is interconnected. And that my life here, my existence here, is dependent upon all these things. I'm a very important, you know, I'm the culmination in many ways of all the past, the labors of my parents, the bravery of my great-grandfather, the suffering of my father. So he said, you need to go to school. So they worked hard to educate us, things like that. On the other hand, gratitude, the Buddhist notion of gratitude also entails great responsibility. Because if we're all interconnected, you know, we can't screw up. You know, we screw up, everything around us collapses. You know, a family, if if I do something bad, it's not only me that's affected, but you know, my wife will be sad, my daughter will be embarrassed, all my ancestors will be ashamed.
Yeah.
Recently, when I first started, in the late 70s, early 80s, when I understood this cardinal Buddhist principle of interdependence, there was not much talk about it, and people kind of make fun of me. I remember, not much fun, but they say, oh, well, you know. But recently, because of the internet, you know, that's a prime example of interconnectedness of all things.
Yeah.
And every computer terminal is a center. And it can draw all things to it. But also this one center can spread and disseminate information to all things because of this interconnectedness. So the metaphor is very real, and I think it's becoming more and more accepted. And we see in environmentalists, they say we can't do any fracking now because it'll affect our groundwater.
Right, that's right.
I mean, and those things were not too prevalent in the past, if I recall. So there is hope in this world. We can all have righteous anger in the sense that if a great company or a powerful person is screwing us up, we can all band together. And this, mm-hmm. Grassroots movement is a kind of demonstration of the strength of networking.
Mm, yeah. Yeah.
Networking is power.
When you go out and the hat that you're wearing is the man who knows something about Asian views of getting old and dying, I'm guessing you're also, have your Buddhist hat.
Yes.
there too. It doesn't have to be named Buddhist, but it's,
yes,
that's also related, is it not?
That's true. When I was much younger, I used to be kind of self-righteous, you know how it is.
Yeah.
But as you get older, you realize you can't tell people how to do it. You need to really teach by example. I guess mentorship is very important, and that's another virtue that elders can provide for us. And that's standard Asian teaching, and successive generations of people. We look up to our elders. We look up to our heroes of the past. And they're bad heroes too, so we can ignore them.
Yeah.
But there are good examples that we need to learn from. Who else do we have to learn from?
Comparing the Western, let's say in the U.S. here, that ideal of rugged individualism, mm. which can be carried to extremes,
right,
in this country,
right.
compared to the traditional cultures that you're kind of speaking from, where one feels dependent upon the others,
right.
your family, and the other people in the culture who are performing needed tasks,
sure.
that support everybody. That how do you see this sort of almost diametrically divided sort of picture between the rugged individual and a culture that understands our interdependence?
Well, the idea of a rugged individual is very American. And of course, that goes back. In Western thinking and American thinking, the idea of autonomy is very strong. You know, that's the basis for American law, and that I suppose would be the metaphysical, philosophical basis for the rugged individualism, individuals. However, having said that, and taking it from the Buddhist point of view or the communal point of view, that rugged individual who crosses the Oregon Trail or whatever it is and stands up can only do that because he or she is supported by this whole vast culture from which he or she emerges from, the way he speaks this language, the skills he learned to fend for himself in the wild, can only happen within a context in which he learned all those skills, and one learns that not from oneself, but not entirely but oneself, but is supported or prior knowledge, as it were. So that would be the Buddhist answer to that. You know, oftentimes, you know, I grew up in the, I guess, mid-60s, when the Vietnam War was escalating. It was a bad time. I have a, I became a conscientious objector. And I was very proud of that. But I was able to do that only to become a conscientious objector because there are people willing to go and to Vietnam and fight. And you know, in a sense, I'm deep. You know, we're all complicit, in a sense. Yeah. I can only be who I am, a pacifist, because the country allowed me to do that, and there are people willing to go over there or whatever, World War II, whatever, to able to execute the national policy.
Right.
So even in my own pride, I'm very complicit because, in a sense, I can be who I am because there are others willing to do, as it were, the dirty work.
That's really interesting that you bring that up. That seems that true. I know, speaking for myself, it's pretty late in life for me that I began to feel some question about who is this I that I had, this automatic I this, I that. Rather late for me to begin to question, is this really true? This automatic, unquestioned, taking for granted, this is my intelligence or my talent or whatever I can do, it's mine. And to begin to look a little more deeply and realize this is something I got from my father, from my mother, and they got it from their parents. And it opened up a question for me, how much of what I take for granted as mine really is mine and hasn't, in fact, been given to me, and now I put that word I on it.
You remember when, I guess it was the first Bush was running for president, and Clinton said, it takes a village to raise a child. And he says, no. And, you know, there was a big back and forth that, and he kind of mocked that. He says, no, it takes a family, not the whole village. So the Buddhist view would be the whole village, well, and by extension, the whole universe, the whole world, whole universe, to raise a child. That would be the Buddhist response.
I guess what I would say, West versus East, or in comparison to the wisdom of the East, the philosophy of the East, and the philosophy of the West, would be egotism in the West. And I don't know what the opposite of that would be, but it would not be egotism. It would be a kind of reverence or a belief that there's something greater than the ego that we must really, that we draw our meaning from.
Sure, sure. Well, the rugged individualism, I think, forgets the context in which he or she lives or operates or is a rugged individualism, individualist. It's not only the West, you know, I think all societies that are small or communal society was actually very communal. That is, we depended upon each other to grow food, hunt, and, you know, common defense, whatever. So somehow, not so much the West, but the modernization has doomed this communal feeling, when modernization meant individualism, my personality is supreme, you know, that's so all of those things, I think, especially the idea that we can exist only by our temperament, like those people that went up in Oregon and took over that farmland, whatever it is. They don't want to pay, you know, that's a rugged individualism, I guess.
Yeah.
But they can only do that within the context that the American government sort of tolerates that.
That's right, yeah.
And they were breaking the law. And unfortunately, or fortunately, we have to live with other people.
And now, as technology seems to be eliminating more and more human interactions mm-hmm. through automatic processes, robots, and so forth, in a way, we're losing less and less mm-hmm. ability to just interact face to face and as people. And the whole idea behind all of this, that this is progress, is a very odd, in a way,
yes,
it's a very odd idea of progress.
Yes.
Do you ever reflect about this kind of thing?
A little bit,
yeah.
But that I would agree with that. That the automatic door is a good example.
Yeah.
Opening a door for someone. That interaction is very important, even if for that just one interaction.
Yeah.
I really think so, yes.
Well, the post office that I go to, the door's not automatic. You could press a button and make it open. But what happens, and it happened today, is that someone held the door for me. I thank them. And even at Starbucks this morning when I was going to Starbucks, a guy got out across from me and I got out, and it's like, who's going to charge in front of the other one, right? To get in there first. And I thought, I've got to restrain myself. I'm going to let this guy go first. And he went in first, and then he held the door for me, and he said, no, you go first.
There you go.
You know what? That was actually a very rich, it
yes.
seems trivial, but it actually, it was full of meaning. And there was something nourishing about it.
Sure. That's a very Confucian moment. Confucian would say that we learn humanity through etiquette.
That's beautiful.
Yeah, well, that's fundamental. That idea is quite prevalent in East Asia and other places. Yet. And I think almost any traditional society has that. Confucius just happened to articulate that.
Is there a greater good there that's not just, I do this, I scratch your back, you scratch mine? Is there something actually more, I mean, I guess I would, I think as a Buddhist would say there's something fundamentally, almost metaphysically, good and needed.
Right.
It's not just about self-serving.
No. The Buddhists would say, and this is not my idea, and it's a very ancient idea, that by doing mutual good to each other, we uplift all of us.
And
we rise and we fall as one living body. That would be the Buddhist answer.
How do you feel about that?
Pretty good, yeah.
You subscribe to that?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
So it also, even if we do a little good, then it doesn't move the earth as it should, humanity or we should. But that little act of kindness uplifts all of us as human beings. And conversely, it will demean all of us as human beings if I did something that's untoward to someone else, or to the earth, or whatever.
That to me seems an important thing for more of us in the West to embrace somehow and to be moved by. I was reading something about Native American speech and their view about speech.
Mm.
And what I remember reading is that there was an understanding that giving voice was to send something out into the world. And that once it went out into the world, it was a done deal, and it was going to have its effect, and it would continue to ripple. So therefore, it was wise to exercise a certain amount of care about what you gave voice to. And somehow that seems to me
not like some politicians I know. No, that's true. I mean, I would say yes. Hopefully,
because of this interconnection,
what goes out is beneficial. Will have lasting beneficial effects.
And conversely, right?
Oh, conversely, yes, yes.
Well, it's, I mean,
that's kind of like what karma is.
Could you just say what's your general kind of stance in regard to the value and the efficacy and the truth of karma as a real idea or a principle, a real principle?
Well, like any idea, it had its flaws, ideologically. But in the Buddhist, well, karma is not, of course, is not special to Buddhism. When the Buddha came around, you know, karma was already operative in the world, in his world.
I see.
He had to use that and accommodate it to the conditions of the world. So he reinterpreted it.
I see.
To make it a Buddhist interpretation.
Okay.
Now, karma is a very cause and effect. It's a simple. Simply, it means if there's a cause, there's an impact, or there's some impact. And it is very simplistic. But Buddha says, well, you know, that's true. But there's also conditions which cause karma to deviate, to modify itself. So, for example, if I want to cross the street, I have the will to cross the street, but I may be struck by a car. I couldn't fulfill my own destiny, as it were.
Right.
Similarly, you know, I want to become a doctor. I go to school and become a doctor, but my father dies. I have no money.
Right.
So the conditions around the will might be modified. So the Buddhist idea of karma is really one of causes and conditions, and that's his motivation. That's his contribution to Indian thought.
Causes and conditions.
Yeah. And we can create karma by three ways, according to ancient India and Buddhist, through speech. So we have mudras, you know. That have effect mudras. I'm sorry, mudra is our fingers, our act, through mind, through speech, and through action. These are the three ways karma is created. So mind is visualization. So we have a mandala, and we have a mantra,
right?
And a mantra. And then we have a mudra, you know, all these funny fingers that they have.
Right.
So these are the three ways that karma is created. And we can use these, later Buddhists would say, mainly the tantric tradition, to effectuate our own spiritual progress.
Mm-hmm.
And they believe, because they believe that there are many forces that traverse the universe, and we just have to ride one or tap into one of those, and we can ride it to enlightenment.
Do you have some familiarity with, let's say, an Islamic perspective, a Taoist perspective? I mean, you've spoken about a Confucian perspective, and I mean, Shinto would be Japanese, and then shamanic perspectives. All these different perspectives.
Sure.
I'm sure there's others, including the Christian, which has migrated into the East also.
Sure.
What's your relationship with those different aspects of Asian thought and religion?
Well, I think I make a distinction between a single center view of the universe, which would be the Abrahamic traditions, Christianity, Judaism, Islam, and the non-multi-centered universe, That's the way I make my distinction.
Mm-hmm.
And Buddhism is the latter.
Okay, yeah.
And most non-theistic faith traditions, like Shinto, shamanic tradition, Taoism, Confucian, belong to the non-monotheistic Abrahamic tradition. This is how I distinguish. Now, the Abrahamic traditions is the single center universe has a specific kind of standard in which all things are viewed. And it's a standard which we judge right and wrong. And I think from my own understanding is this is where the problem comes in, because we are not as Buddhists, because we don't subscribe to a single center universe, we're not included in that vision. It's hard to know what these traditions have to say about growing old, but my view is that all of these faith traditions is very simple. They tell us they ask and try to answer what are our greatest aspirations. Mm-hmm. And for Buddhists, the aspiration is to be freed from suffering.
Yes.
And for all beings to be freed from suffering. And every faith tradition has that. And the problem with faith traditions is that once some guy with a paper or something writes it down, then we have problems.
Yes.
Because then we say, well, he said that, this is what he means, and all the commentaries arise, and we have all this philosophy.
Right.
So that's aspiration. Is all faith traditions deal with very simple things, like what our aspiration as a human being, as a people, as a community, what are our
yes.
greatest aspirations? The other one would be, what are our deepest yearnings? And they're very close together. Our yearnings is to, you know, have a stable life, no war, so I can educate my children.
Right.
And these are our yearnings. And in Syria now, in the Middle East, their yearning is for peace.
Isn't that ironic?
Yeah. And the third thing, which I think they have is what are our greatest beliefs? You know, what are, so these are the three things I think these faith traditions have. And belief can be, well, I believe in one God. I believe that the whole universe is sacred. You know, and then the philosophers come in and try to make sense out of these things. When in the past, you know, we believe these things, well, the past of people, they believed in these things intuitively.
Right.
It's philosophers that screw up all these things and make it and theologians and they build the institutions,
right?
And
right.
all hell breaks loose.
There's a view among certain Western scientists, probably atheists. I mean, atheists are okay. I mean, no problem. But there's a kind of attitude among some scientific atheists that we don't need meaning, we don't need intelligence, we don't need any idea
right.
that there's any
right.
thing that we could look to metaphysically
okay.
for comfort, that there's no meaning
sure.
inherent
okay.
metaphysically.
Yeah.
It's a mindless,
sure.
meaningless
sure.
world of
sure.
forces.
Sure.
If we're going to find meaning, we're going to have to cook it up ourselves,
okay.
you know.
I haven't spent much time thinking about these people, but I would say that they probably have a point that there may not be any meaning outside, you know, some metaphysical supernatural force. And the Buddhists would probably subscribe to that. However, the Buddhist would say there is meaning with relationship with people. And I say that because the Buddha says there are certain questions that should never be asked. Is there life after death? Where did I come from? Where are we going? These are not Buddhist questions. the Buddhists don't ask these questions. They don't entertain them because the Buddha says the greatest question is your own spiritual liberation. And that you can do by yourself, through yourself, through meditation, and the support of your community. That's what the Buddhists would say.
Okay.
And even these people, they can say that because there's no meaning, because they're reacting to the view that there is meaning in the world. So, you know, they're themselves, their position is dependent upon.
Right, that's true.
Yeah, so.
That's true, yeah.
With those people, I would probably go out and have beer and have a good time.
Yeah. Well, a Dalai Lama apparently has said, if science can prove that any of our understandings are wrong, we'll have to change them.
Yeah, well, of course.
What is the category, art and religion?
Sure.
Why is that a category, and why are the two of them a part of one category?
I'll give you my view.
Okay.
From the Buddhist standpoint, or at least the traditional standpoint, East Asian or South Asian, art is really, let's make it very concrete. Just because a piece of work, we call it material religion now, sculpture, temples, whatever, paintings, something that's very tangible, material, that's a fancy word now, material religion. It's not a piece of material religion or art is not, a piece of work is expresses religion or is represents religion not because it has a Buddhist theme or Christian theme or whatever, but only a true religious art or spiritual art is art if it expresses or conveys something of the spiritual experience. So Buddhist art, even if I did a painting of Bodhidharma, it may not necessarily be Buddhist art because it does not express or convey anything of the experience of Buddhism or the truth of Buddhism. That would be my definition of religious or spiritual art.
That's a very interesting definition. And would you say something about how do you know?
Well, how do we know?
How do we know when a work of art
yes.
expresses something
yes.
of the spiritual?
Well, the creator, that is the artist, whether he's an artist or dancer or poet, is able to embody, that is, live that life. Then his or her work will naturally give expression to that tradition. Now, the Renaissance really screwed us up because people now begin to sign things. Individualism, you know,
right.
A rugged individualism.
Right.
But in the past, of course, artisans never signed their work, only from the Renaissance. Well, in Asia they did, you know, they signed it. But if and when a piece of work embodies the tradition, then that is a representation or representative, or an expression of that faith tradition. Now, how do we recognize that? You know, that's a big question. And I would say that a great piece of work, of spiritual work, reaches beyond its confines, embraces, and draws you in. Then we would know. So it's an intuitive thing. It's not something that I can quantify.
Right.
So that's the hard part.
Yes. So you're saying that the piece of art that truly does embody something can be felt.
Felt, felt is good. It can be known.
Okay. Can be known.
Yeah, because feeling is a kind of knowing.
Yes. That's something we don't understand much in the West, I don't think, that feeling is a modality of knowing.
Well, you love somebody and you know it.
I don't dispute it. I think it's very interesting. I think it's unfortunate that it's not understood more in the West, that there's an intelligence of feeling.
Oh, yes, very much so, yes, very much.
And not everybody has the same degree of openness, so.
Sure. Well, it's hard, you know. It's hard.
So you may have a piece of true religious art, but someone might not feel it.
They may not be open to it. And oftentimes it has to be cultivated. You know, like my calligraphy.
Right.
And it's a very subtle art. And it has to be cultivated. So I was lucky in a sense that I was able to cultivate this after so many years, through so many years. I'm very fortunate. But you know, that cultivation also sensitizes me to other forms of art. And I appreciate that. Mm-hmm. When you do these things, you never know where it's going to turn out. You know, when I started 40 years ago, I thought, well, just do it. I was interested, but I didn't know where it would lead me.
Right, there's no way to think your way through where you might go. You take the step, and then something opens.
But you have to have faith somehow. Rather real or intended or wistful, whatever, willingly, that something will come of this. But you never know. And the only way you can know this thing, as far as I can see, is that you have a mentor who went through that.
Yes.
An elder who went through life.
Yes. Yeah.
And so elders are good teachers.
Yeah. Well, in Asia, there are art forms in which the art of show, I mean, Japanese traditions, it seems to me, are a very good example of art forms that, in the interview that Peter Dobler did with you, you said, at its best, one becomes a human being.
Oh, did I say that?
Well, yes, I mean, I the quote is not quite exact, but there was something about the practice of a certain, let's just say in the context of Zen Buddhism, the practice of brush painting or archery or
whatever, yes,
that what is being practiced, there's an outer representation, but equally important, essential, is an inner, something that's an invisible part to that. And you said it's something about teaching us how to be human some way.
I recall that now. But that's true, because once a person masters a craft or anything, masters himself, it's a human project to master something. And in the process, I'm sure you learn something, not only of the craft, but of yourself. It can be auto fixing cars, whatever, gardening.
Yeah, yeah.
And to acquire this skill, one reacts with the material, in this case, the soil, the plants, the flowers. So I enjoy my flowers.
Yeah.
Every chance I have, I'm out there.
Well, I was just going to sort of contrast some of the Eastern understandings of art that where there's a mentor, a master. And in the West, we don't have that. We don't have it at all.
We don't have that, yes.
There isn't any idea of any spiritual aspect, really. It's like, I think Rothko might be an example in the abstract expressionism of something where there was something along those lines, but not like in the East.
Yeah. I've been very fortunate. I've had good teachers. I've met good people who became good teachers. Whether I stayed with them for a long time or only a few minutes or a few days, whatever. But, you know, it takes a certain kind of recognition on my part that I'm, this man is a teacher, or yes. this woman is a teacher.
Yes.
So I've been very fortunate.
Yeah.
I've been very fortunate.
I think it's so fascinating that the limitations of our thought, which in the West we have so much confidence in, what I would call perfectly expressed by Descartes' cogito ergo sum, I think therefore I am. And I could say from an Eastern point of view, my ordinary thought, I think, can get me anywhere.
No, that's true. I would agree with you.
And it is a very limited tool.
Sure, sure.
Because my ordinary thought can't really think my way through. I mean,
but ordinary feelings can.
Say more about that.
Well, you know, if the mind is not the only way we know. You know, we feel, we dance, whatever. You know, and this can lead us to wherever we want to go.
Mm. Is that, would you say that that's, could you say that's an Asian understanding, or,
no.
or maybe traditional societies, cultures understand that? It would be wrong to nail it down geographically, but...
In the West, of course, we put emphasis on the written word, that is, the intellect. But the human experience is more than just thinking. It's also feeling.
One of the things that came up in our conversation is that you were telling me about the artist at times has an experience which hasn't been made, which hasn't been brought into form for the culture at large, but which that artist occasionally succeeds in bringing into form. And I think you were saying that this was in a way a way of mapping an experience and making it visible for
yes,
others.
Yes.
Is this resonating for you, what I'm trying to...
I think that book was called, that I was referring to, was the Giacometti portrait.
Uh-huh.
I think it was by James Lord, who was sitting for Giacometti, said, I'll paint you. And every time Giacometti would start, he would paint. At the end of the day, he says, this is going nowhere, so he'd destroy it.
Yeah.
Let's start again tomorrow. And this went on for weeks.
Okay.
And the guy said, you know, I really got to get back to New York. It's so soon, you know, he said, so soon. It's almost there. It's almost, can't you stay another day? So this went on, and the portrait was unfinished, of course. So I think, I don't know Giacometti too well, but... And I think that's what an artist struggles with. But everyone struggles with that. So how do we give that thought or feeling form? You know, that's the meaning of formless form, giving form to the formless.
Yeah.
All artists, I think, are struggling with that. Not only me, not only Giacometti, whatever. How to give, articulate, in this case, for me, line and space, for the colorist, paint and form, for the sculptor, form and space, for the composer, sound.
Yeah.
We all struggle with this. You know, for you, it's how do you give form to this interview? How do you translate it into words and images onto the printed page? Editor do that.
Yeah,
editor
yeah.
is the worst job.
you know from experience
know.
There, right? You know, something that was in the interview that Peter Dobler did with you that I feel was kind of a great gift to me is, and you were speaking of giving form to the formless, that it was giving form to those intuitions, those feelings, those understandings, those glimpses, those insights that I might have. Those, that's formless.
That's true.
And that was so helful to sort of...
It's a problem of translation too. How what is the best media or form to give form to what you're feeling or intuitively know. So it's a problem of translation.
Well, absolutely. And a friend of mine, an artist, said the biggest problem for an artist is not to be deluded. Oh. And what he meant, I think, by that is, I feel like it's there, but is it? Is it there?
Sure. What is the authentic feeling or thought? But we all struggle with that, even people in the sciences. They have an intuition of what the universe is like, you know, this theoretical physicist, they make some mathematical formulations. So they're trying to give form to their intuition of what the physical universe is supposed to be like. Well, those are what theories are.
Oh, that's beautiful.
That's what I think anyway.
Yeah. I like it.
I don't think too much of these things, you know. When I get a little hard, I go and take care of my plants.
Well, all right, thank you, Ron.
Thanks a lot, Richard. Thanks for coming by here.
Oh, yeah, my pleasure. Thanks.